Everything in my life, in my crib, are things I either couldn't afford as a child or wasn't strong enough to have. Everything except hope. There are three things we grew up with in our neighborhood, and that's drugs, guns, and gangs. You can hear all about it in any of the top 10 rap records in the last 10 years. But for y'all know-it-alls, here's the juice. There's a difference between being a hip-hop historian and being an example of hip-hop's living history. Watch me and see how many are the acts of one man in which we recognize in ourselves the same character. Our power consists in a multitude of our affinities. But down by law, not by luck, what? We have the same national mind expressed for us again in our published works, in our epic and lyric poems, films, and philosophy. We were given the gift of perpetual youth so we could bend the desires of the mind and fit our imagined quality of life. Fast cars, good food, better sex, and lots of fucking money. That was always my idea of fame. To be immortalized by my peers as either the first, the best, or the only one. But I wanted it in the street by the code that's in the book. We all did. Our nature is an endless combination and repetition of very few laws. Wear your flyer shit every day. Look somebody in the eye and tell them no. Be your own boss. Don't take no shit from anybody. Make the rest of it up yourself. This whole thing was our idea. The quality, the equipment, the clothes, the sneakers, and the style. Ideas have endurance without death. They are immortal. Ponce de Leon didn't find no fucking fountain of youth. Everyone knows that. Hip-hop is the fountain of youth, and everybody know that. It's a journey of enlightenment and social studies that begins with your first mixtape and ends when your mic goes out. Make no mistake, in a culture such as ours, you cannot draw the line where a race begins and ends. The most I could do is show you who was there and how we got your kids.
You didn't have Game Boy and Nintendo and television and cable. You just had the street. So by all these kids that had no direction being in the street and rubbing up against each other like locusts, that's where this culture came from. It came from a rhythm, but it came through ancient sources. The DJ was the drum. The MC was the griot.
I gotta get your number, man, because I want to copy it.
The graffiti cat, that was the guys who painted on the walls of caves and sides of mountains and pyramids. These forces of all these kids rubbing together like crickets created this drum beat, created this energy, and that's where it came from.
Stay in tune with the street and always be able to connect with the current.
Hip-hop opens its arms to everyone, mostly the poor or the underprivileged community. This is where they feel that they can get a sense of belonging.
The Greeks, the Romans ran things, the Egyptians. They ran the world, ran civilization, and then they disappeared, and you go to museum and see them. But if we just stay low and remember where it really came from, here, the people, working people, poor people, you know, decent people, people that just don't even want a whole bunch out of life but to feel good.
Keeping on to the crack of dawn because the busy bee. Charlie Chase is playing Funky President.
Everybody having fun and just partying. No killing, no shooting, no fighting, just partying.
At the house, we work it out.
South Bronx record, taking it to clubs with a gang of motherfuckers, like 30 deep, and being in the middle of the club, and as soon as record came on, oh, South Bronx doing real street promotion, early.
Brothers and sisters!
Back in the day, was real creative.
Yeah, and this is the art, like, you feeling, you're crazy.
I used to be a little nigga listening.
Rap music doesn't create these things. These things are here.
The battle with LL Cool J, Kumo D. Battle of Dizzy B with Kumo D.
A new device of this generation that expresses a person itself. Device of this generation.
Begin of a climate, something big, classics.
I seen an African Bambaataa concert before. I don't know if a lot of people ever had a chance to see that.
Rap started on the street, now it's headed into mainstream and pop.
I used to work at Red's Toy Store, and you just saving your money so you can take all this money of your hard work for the whole maybe 6-7 months to buy a drum machine.
KRS-One, Scott LaRock, street poetry. The essence of hip-hop is street poetry.
And how could you prefer to be with those that sprayed you with guns and holes and never put roses on the graves of the slaves that they treated like dirt?
For me, it started as a thing on the streets for respect. You battle somebody, you take their name, take their identity from them.
It's gonna continue straight ahead till someone turns out the light on this small planet. Can you dig it?
Two turntables in the garage with a mic, doing mixtapes on TDKs.
Rakim and Eric B with Eric B for President. Oh my God, what is that?
It's called Feel the Face.
It's the beginning of history.
9, 10 of us, 40 ounce down, weeded down, primo down. Anything we get our hands on that inspire us to get into the groove or something and just start rapping.
My mother brought home Apache and Breakbeat, and she brought home Rappers Delight. I had them two records back and forth, but I was already rocking. 12 years old, I did my first house party. I got like 20 seconds. You know, the big boy's like, hey, that's enough, E.
We had was more like a family than a group.
Most of us, especially those of us that entered the culture fairly early, were people who wanted to be different.
I see that you can tell already, so Pete.
The freshness, you didn't sound and look original. You was a biter.
All your rhymes sounded the same. You was whack.
Old school for the music, the roots playing, coming from the roots, coming from the gut, the heart. Now it's all about technology.
Technology has taken over.
Pushing buttons. That's what I miss. Real music.
I can sell like 4 times as many records if I would just go pop.
Growing up in the Bronx, guys bring out their equipment. In a matter of an hour or two, it's like the Pied Pipers in the middle of the park. People coming from all over so they could party and have fun.
Once hip-hop came in, it was like a whole new world. Something brand new that the youth felt like was a part of them. And it was something that our people created, so it was even that much more special to us.
In 1977, the lights went out, and an uncivil war broke out in the streets of Gotham. By the summer of 79, a new power had arisen from out of the old. Through disco.com for dope music came hip-hop, which was first named by Malcolm X in his autobiography. The hood was now controlled by a multi-ethnic confederacy that held emblematic magnetism on new heroes. On our four corners stood the graffiti artist, you know, Bomber, the DJ, the B-boy, and the MC. Their pomp and graphic definitions of everyday life and how to beat the odds to us became the idealism. Here are some of our role models, the ones who had the illest record collections ever assembled, street preachers of faith who made themselves works of art.
When I came up, man, it was Treacherous 3, Kumo D, Cold Crush 4, Grandmaster Cash, Melly Mel from the Furious 5. Those are three of my favorite rappers and three of my favorite groups. Coming up from that era, man, put a lot on me, man. I'm glad to be part of that era and also glad to be here today. It's a blessing, man.
Marvin Gaye, Donnie Hathaway.
Aretha Franklin, Marvin Gaye, Temptations, Four Tops, Curtis Mayfield, Barry White.
KRS was one of my favorite MCs. I learned a lot from him at distance, performing on stage, delivery, projection on the mic.
Teddy Riley, Howie T, Marley Marl.
BC Express,
mass production.
Firecracker.
Salt and Pepper.
We listened to a lot of reggae.
Grandmaster Flash and Cold Crush Brothers.
The whole Motown era, you know, Jackson 5, Diana Ross, and Prince. Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, Junior Walker and the All-Stars.
It was EPMD a lot for me. I was influenced by Run DMC.
Run DMC for sure, LL.
UTFO, I got UTFO first album. How fucking big is that?
Funkadelic.
Big up to Funkadelic Parliament.
My man Bootsy.
Hell yeah, James Brown.
James Brown for one. My top mentor is my father. I got a chance to learn what it was to work a crowd on stage and know that when you get on stage, it's about your command and you run the room.
He is just like the father to me and Keith as far as the music game.
Back then, my father had all these records and I just like,
I guess when I was young, he played all these jams. When I got older, I knew what stuff should sound like.
The West Coast had me taken by storm when I was little because I was rolling with Snoop back in the day.
My mom, my grandfather, a lot of the R&B music that I listened to as a kid, Earth, Wind & Fire, Isley Brothers, people that I seen on TV, the athletes, whoever that I seen that was doing it, and I liked the way they was doing it, I looked at them as an inspiration to me, and I wanted to pattern myself around them.
I wouldn't be nowhere without certain brothers in this game that took the time to sit me down, show me the structure, share with me, and straight up have a major input into what I was trying to become.
I have to say Ultramagnetic and Kool Keith especially probably the person made me want to run.
Yo, I can do this and make money. Run DMC did that for me.
Growing up, my father brought me a guitar. You know, I was taking a couple of lessons with the guitar. I was able to play it a little bit, but once I seen Grandmaster Flash doing his thing in the Armory back in like 79 in Queens somewhere, I was a little kid like, yo, that's what I want to do. You know, that's that guy right there, he don't need nobody to come to band practice. He could do it all by himself.
Cameo on the barcades, you know what I mean? That's real music right there.
KRS-One, NWA, EPMD, Big Daddy Kane.
Even Average Right Band.
Yeah, real funk, man. Cut the cake.
Word.
Master Don and the Funk Committee.
I love Latifah. I love MC Light. I love Salt and Pepper. I love Lauryn Hill.
Rakim, Big Daddy Kane, to me, myself, the KRS-One.
Yo, between the years of 1979 and 82, man, without a doubt, the greatest moments of music I ever heard. 105.9 WNWK was a community radio station broadcasting from Newark, New Jersey. Belonged to the world-famous Supreme Team, and their show belonged to us.
WHBI, man. Marley Scratch. When I first heard the Marley Scratch, MC Shan was crazy to me.
Stretch Armstrong, his name's Adrian Bartos, who graduated in 88. I'm like, dude, Stretch Armstrong is an Adrian Bartos. I'm like, Stretch Armstrong is black. I listen to the show every week. Stretch Armstrong was Adrian Bartos and is white.
Live at the Sands, Susan. Y'all niggas know what I'm talking about, huh? 100! Live at the Sand Stutzen, man, on AM radio.
There was a station called KDET, which was a 24-hour hip-hop station. It was an AM station. Red Alert came out to L.A., and he came to visit me, and Red came to the office. Kids were, like, passing out in the office.
It was definitely Red Alert, Mr. Magic, the world premiere.
Stretch Armstrong and BLS with Chuck Chill Out and Mr. Magic.
The first official and highly anticipated hip-hop film, Yes, Wild Style, Get It Right, had crushed the critics and four station managers to jump on our dick. The top radio stations were still playing disco hits and rappers delight, but wouldn't give the dope shit any burn from programmers until Africa Bambaataa and cool DJ Red Alert Murph 98.7 Kiss FM's primetime slot. And you know what? We got recognized, kid.
The guys back in the days, they used to be real hardcore gangster guys because you had to remember, you had to break into the yard. If you was weak or soft, you wasn't about to be nobody. You had to have heart. We used to call it racking up. If you couldn't steal paint, then you wasn't gonna be in the game, and don't worry about being the king. Now you had to get into the yard. Once you're in that yard, now you're breaking the law. There's a live third rail to add dangers beside the police. Then was very intimidating with those big ass fucking trains. When your adrenaline is pumping, you don't perform like you're supposed to perform if you wasn't built for this game. You would take over your projects first, then your neighborhood, then you would come on the trains. And that's how you would build up. But when once you hit the trains, you're in the major leagues now. I was up, all my niggas was up. We were bigger than rock stars.
I'm Crack TS. I became Joey Crack the Rapper because of my graffiti name. I got thrown out of a bunch of junior high schools, pile up pillows in my bed, sneak out my house so my mother could think I was sleeping, getting caught on the trains. It was a beautiful experience for me. Now when I write my rhymes, I always got another piece of paper and I'm doing throw up or a piece.
Because the times were so hard back then, so a lot of creativity took place, man. Whenever you have poor people, you have creativity because we have to think of ways to express ourselves. I'm not ashamed or embarrassed about this at all. This is how I make my living and I enjoy myself doing it. I'd rather be doing this than anything else in the world.
Now to get looked at as a legend, listen up. You gotta present yourself as one. First thing is to get a T-Connection tape with Master Don and the Death Committee. Can't just know somebody out there. You gotta walk the talk. That means not waiting till Easter for a new pair of pro kids, man. Shit, if you get your ass out of bed and shovel snow or wash a couple of cars, you'd earn a couple of pairs. Got it?
It's like that, and that's the way it is.
That's with little white boys, that's with black kids, everything. When new sneakers come out, you always want to get the hottest sneakers.
I like exclusive Nike sneakers, I like Jordans.
We looking for Michael Jordan, trying to get the key to his house so we can go get that exclusive shit that he hiding from the world.
Rappers are very particular about their footwear.
Nikes, Adidas, Converse.
Oh, baby. My sneaker collection, man, is ridiculous. My footwear is up to par, man.
I just made your whole outfit. When I come outside, I don't have one anyone looking like. I can't have the same shit on no more.
I give shoes away. I got little brothers.
I go buy me some $30 shoes like I got on right now. I don't give a fuck about that shit.
Obsessed that have 300 pairs of sneakers and just on eBay and Jam and the internet just trying to find that one pair of brown suede Air Force Ones that they only made 10 of in Japan. And
yo, you got these? They only came in this color.
In Atlanta, I have a whole room of Air Force Ones.
It's bad. It's really Air Force Ones, Pumas.
Pops probably got 400, 500 pairs of sneakers. It's disgusting over there.
You ask a lot of women, man, they look at that, man, how a man's shoe look.
All vintage shit, man. Shipping Japan, shipping Europe.
Sneakers is never gonna go out. When jewelry, when everything's over, still gonna be sneakers.
If you're poor, broke, and lonely, like myself, then you gotta learn how to preserve your shit.
If you got on wax sneakers or nasty sneakers, that means you're a bum.
It ain't just one thing with me, I like flavors.
You know what I'm saying? I put them motherfuckers on there now, then be like, yeah. They're the ones I rocked in, you know what I'm saying, 94.
All I buy is Adidas.
When I get home tonight, I'm gonna get the paper that it's originally comes with the shoe that they stuff it, and I'm gonna stuff the shoe and put them away.
Clean or dirty, what would you prefer?
You have white sneakers on, and then you do your break dancing, but you don't wanna scuff your sneakers up, because if you scuff the sneakers, you did it wrong.
The cleaner from Foot Locker, and you clean the sides, but you don't put like soap in the crevices of the shoes or that shit'll get dark.
And once they get scuffed up, that's a wrap.
It's all in the makeup of a B-girl or B-boy.
Or you can start off as a bag man in a supermarket. Maybe then you can move up to messenger. Now after your kicks is correct, you move up to clothes. Then to haircuts and chains. That'll get you looked at plus some points with the old joints on the block, know what I mean? Then you get schooled.
I'm not the best DJ. There's DJs that'll bust my ass. Literally get up on the turntables and make me look like a total fool. Starting with Steve D. Starting with Rock Waiter. Starting with DJ Scratch. Those are cats that sleep on turntables. They got tricks and do all kind of shit. Just so happened I took the party route. You see me come in and I'm yelling and I'm screaming. And I'm going crazy. I'm doing that because that's what I want them to feel. I want them to feel like this is the craziest kid I ever seen. And I might not be doing shit. I might not be doing nothing. But just by the way I hit the mix or the way I look or my eye, I mean, just bug people out. Because it looked like something that they can't do. That's the shit!
Let's go back to setting an example where you had to be skillful to get on the mic. You have to have your own true sound instead of gang of producers on your shit just to get on, or a hot producer just to get on. It's about the producer from around your way that gave you that sound that made you stand out from everybody. Let's get back to that shit.
Your training consists of the things that matter to your own survival and the lifestyle you uphold. The things that you must spend tens of thousands of dollars on over the next decade to be legitimized as a recognized member of a past generation. You must learn how to get outfitted, carry records, drive the truck to and from the jam, and for God's sake, hold down a crew when it's your turn to rap.
Always be a historian and a studier of the culture and the art so that you can value it fully, regardless what the era is. Old school, present school, future school, whatever the fuck era you from, Just understand every element about it as much as you can. Be in tune with it so that you can turn with the turning points. You can change with the changes. You can adjust with the adjustments. And that's how I did it. That's how I keep doing it. I'm a fan of the music first.
If you stay with the style you began with it 5 years later, people are gonna be like, ah, man, that does the same shit all over again. So you have to have a good show. You have to be able to uplift people in the crowd, make them bounce, make them slam, make them jump, tear their clothes off, shake their ass. Whatever it is, you have to have good presence on stage to rock the crowd. You have to have skills with the ink, you know? You gotta be able to write dope shit, whether it's comical, whether it's dramatic. You have to have all those things. You have to be a well-rounded MC, and people these days want an MC who can do it all.
Back then, the station were the only ones that would sponsor our parties. Liquor advertisers don't give a fuck if it was an AA meeting. They'd cover any club because they gonna get paid regardless. And you know we pack shit all the time. But when Run DMC stepped in, man, our quality of life experiment went multinational again. But this time, it came big. The fact that was incredible with their contribution was getting Adidas to give them a lifetime contract. That opened up a lot of opportunities for us to do some serious business and gave birth to the rap industry.
Russell knocked on their door.
If you take Run DMC and my Adidas.
Even with Run DMC, I don't even think kids in the street, consumers of hip hop, even viewed it as his Adidas getting down with Run DMC. And trying to make this marriage to sell a product or what have you.
Run DMC had the first advertisement.
It just seemed like, you know, brothers was rocking Adidas.
On one end, people are like, oh, you're selling out. But on another end, you're still sleeping on mom's couch.
And I saw the Kool-Aid man singing Hip Hop Parade. So I was like, yo, it's a rap. This is to that next level now. It's not just street corner in a park rocking at a party. This is worldwide.
Oh my God, this hip hop thing really works. These kids really love this. It makes money. Hip, hip, the hop, hop, hop. We keep it moving. Not, not stop. Black
eyed peas, yo. We keep it moving. We got to keep it moving. This is gonna help their companies because this is what's happening right now. Hip hop. And that's the best way to market and promote.
I got my own car speakers through JVC. The first hip hop artist ever. And one of the first blacks to deal with a Fortune 500 company, so. I mean, it's big, man.
A lot of cats are getting endorsement deals now. With me, Campbell Soup, they want to do something with me, and that's hot.
For myself, I'm a writer. When I write something, I would rather everybody hear it, not just one group of people. The more people that listen to it, the better. The artists need to start understanding that and really grabbing a hold of the power that we have and put it to use.
Once it hit Madison Avenue, it's big time.
Madison Avenue, everybody got like some beat in a ad campaign.
It's a good thing to try to get on and latch on. It's making a lot of money for them.
You ain't gonna just see Busta Rhymes doing Mountain Dew commercials for nothing. You sure he's getting a big chunk of money?
That shit came about like everything else that came about. When some shit is successful, everybody want their hands in the motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? You got sodas with hip-hop advertising their product. You know what I mean? You got McDonald's with hip-hop advertising their product.
You can't do nothing without hip-hop music. You can't sell McDonald's, you can't sell clothes. Everything got something to do with rap music.
In every way, shape, fashion, or form, it don't matter what it is, it's a hip-hop relevant affiliated situation. When motherfuckers is advertising they law firm if you got hit by a car on some infomercial 1-800-LAWYERS, you hear some hip-hop shit in the background. It's fucking crazy. But it is what it is. And this shit is feeding everybody undeniably and unquestionably. So ultimately, you know, the rich blood suckers of the poor is gonna get their hands in some shit that the poor is gonna always stay poor from, even though we the founding fathers and creators of this shit.
What Busta has done for Cavassier is out of control. They're getting like a not even a fraction of the money that the corporations is making off of our talents.
We wanted to blow up and cross over and do other things, but don't hold back the creativeness of it.
Being able to do a commercial was good for the fact that I was able to be myself and express some reality on a bigger platform. It's a good thing if an artist can keep their integrity and they ain't pushing something that they really just don't believe in. I wouldn't do any liquor commercials or promote like, yeah, I drink this. Even if I'm drinking, I wouldn't do it.
It sucked the life form out of it because it turned into a corporate game. It turned more into a video
presentation.
It just took away the innocence and the love of the game.
Hip-hop is the music, but it's also a business.
Wherever there's money to be found, corporate America will be there. Need to be televised, and we needed Source Awards and all that.
Source Magazine definitely helped. Dave went after corporate America hard. That's when we were involved with Nike, Miramax, Levi's.
I don't really be getting all into that bullshit, man. I got kids to feed, man. You know, I'm just doing this for me and them. As long as my paper's straight, anything else, man, is uncivilized.
Now, you want to talk about films? Then that's the very next thing. Most labels had distribution deals with companies who owned studios. They'd already had big names moving units for them. But if Run DMC was the center of a movie and a dope soundtrack, the studio would make a killing. And it did.
Hollywood likes scandal, and it likes controversy, and it likes hype. Rap has a lot of that.
When you grow up under shitty circumstances, or you've seen a lot, you've lived a lot, you have a lot of experience, that can support your art.
Follow the footsteps of Flavor Unit's great Queen Latifah, Will Smith, LL, Tupac got me in the first joint, Juice. That's when I got bit by the bug.
You see J-Lo doing music, doing movies. You go all the way back to all the old school actors. They all have music careers also. It's always been hand in hand.
They're in the business of, you know, entertainment, making money, sensationalism, fanaticism. So they're definitely going to gravitate towards something that's fascinating.
I take advantage of everything that I get. They want me to go off and do a movie, I'm going to go off and do it if everything is right. And that's the type of person that I am. There's nothing wrong with that.
When you have that element in the movies, it draws a lot of people to see the movies. Hollywood knows that. Otherwise, they wouldn't have it that way.
We have a fan base. And if they include us in certain things they do, and they can make a lot more money.
Just like in the rap game. Sell me some units in a movie thing, fam. When you hot, you hot. Rapping, movie-wise, everything. Commercials, whatever you could do. A book deal. You got to squeeze the juice out of yourself when you hot, because they're going to squeeze the juice out of you at the end of the day.
This business don't love nobody, you heard me? That's what they do. They're in it to make money.
Cube was like, man, I created more jobs in Hollywood than I've ever taken.
The impact that hip-hop has on the world culture and on popular culture. You don't see a whole lot of rock stars and pop stars and R&B stars in movies, but there's lots of hip-hop stars.
The next wave of all of this success is going to be in the movie business. The film business and hip-hop, in conjunction with the soundtrack opportunities that are related to it, we're just going to see the hip-hop movement become bigger and bigger and more successful and stronger in the next decade.
The whole thing revolves around money. Everybody got a price tag on. That's why you gotta keep it tight with your family and whoever you came in with. Besides that, everybody else just look at you, what you can make for them.
Will Smith in that Boys Club, the 20 million a movie actors.
Will Smith, he always related to mainstream. When he crossed over the television and features, he opened the doors.
He blew up from Fresh Prince on.
Let's do the simple answer, 8 Mile. Did huge, did 60-some million its first week. I mean, that's a hip-hop movie if there ever has been one.
Def Jam had every major arena packed with personal power, and the beverage industry was wet for anything that had the kids. I believe it was Sprite, a Coca-Cola company, that poured us our first drink.
It don't have nothing to do with underground. The underground shit is even commercial. That's why 50 Cent come out and sell 6 million records. It's all commercial now. There's no more pop chart.
Look at 50 Cent, the hardest nigga in the streets, selling millions of records. And all that he's talking about is getting shot or shooting a motherfucker. You got these motherfuckers that come out here and sponsor that. They want this nigga to wear their sneaker or drink their soda.
When Pepsi or Coca-Cola attach themselves to such artists, they're saying, we're okay with this.
Back in the day, if you did a commercial or something, that was considered selling out. Nowadays, it's like a standard. And they watering down, it's making it bigger, it's making it stronger, it's making it more powerful.
It really showed other billionaires and millionaires and other entrepreneurs in other forms that this is something that you gotta take serious. So therefore, clothing companies pay attention to the numbers that we do in clothes. Liquor companies pay attention to the numbers that come back when we say their names in our records.
What's happening in rap is niggas write verses and leave about 4 or 5 empty spaces. And they say, well, I can say Hypnotic here, I can say Hennessy, I can say Kavassier. Let's see who'll write the check.
You got these artists, they talking about Versace, Moschino's, and these companies are blowing.
I'm putting your own product in my rhyme. All of your stocks are shooting up out of the fucking sky.
If you want to get to the people that's buying things, this is how you gotta go. It's the best way to go.
Everybody get their day to dance with the devil. Just make sure that you got the right shoes on. If you got Alligator or you got Oscars. Fireproof. You gotta dance with the devil, baby. Make it happen.
We wrote him a letter. Said, man, we don't want that kind of.
cats. We don't want that consumer. All these other cats coming after it, they were just going after, they'd make songs just to get some sneakers. It was like, fuck, I buy my own sneakers. You know, I wasn't gonna sell out for sneakers.
Any group who rep, who feel like they rep hip-hop, the true meaning of it, the essence, the respect for the art first. You throw them a Coke commercial, they'll take it. They want the check.
I don't like to play that shit. I ain't never tried to just go heavy commercial or heavy corporate, whatever. I write what about what the fuck I write about.
Corporate America actually took the game to the next level. It actually blew it up and made it bigger than what it is because they put attention on it and put cameras on it.
The sellout is the change in who you are at your core. I'm not gonna sacrifice what I've worked hard and the dignity that I have. Like, I come from nothing. At the end of the day, a couple cars and a $150,000 house ain't such a bad deal.
Not sacrificing what's real about it for being able to turn a buck, you know? Because money come, money go.
We exploit ourselves. You know, we can't be too mad about it because we're letting them do it. We can stop it, but we're letting them do it, and it's a business. They see money and why not?
They can't never pimp me. They won't get me out there, you know what I'm saying, shucking and jiving for no fucking corn pops and no, you know what I'm saying, and no fucking crispy taquitos. Fuck you.
To everybody in the world wanna be on now.
Corporate America fucked up hip hop.
It's not for me. We were just trying to make music.
The term sellout does not exist anymore. The term moneymaker, baller, you know, millionaire, that's what exists now.
Before, that was a no-no, now it's okay.
If you done a Sprite commercial or something, you were a sellout. Back then, we were like, nah, man, we ain't gonna sell out. But then all of a sudden, you see somebody doing a Sprite commercial, a Dr. Pepper one, this guy does a milk ad. There'd be no millionaire rappers without these people that are putting this money behind it. Hip-hop has the same birth origin as rock and roll did, something that was denied at first, you know, shined on, talked bad about, until this guy put it on his TV show. Welcome the Doors or Elvis Presley.
What we're talking about with the Sprite, that was just the first instance, but it's still growing.
Everything we do starts in the streets, and then one way or another, they're gonna pick up on it.
At the end of the day, it's about making a check.
A company can't start on Madison Avenue, can't start on Park Avenue. A company got to go all the way to the end of Brooklyn and Marcus Garvey in the middle of the third building and start from there. Because that's the essence of all things that come as far as fashion, music, lifestyle.
After getting a sponsor, you had to have a tailored suit, an outward symbol that you have been outfitted.
You had to see Dapper Dan.
He had to lace you with his legendary Gucci, Louis Vuitton, or Fendi improvisation. It meant you were a made man when you bought one of his $2,000 and up designs.
According to how you dress is how good we could tell you is doing.
It's a movement, and people want to be part of it.
Wanting to wear things that no one else was wearing.
People have to have a look as well as a sound.
They needed something to make the image.
When we didn't have those designers, we took the Calvin Kleins, Vidal Sassoons. We just wore them baggy.
Rock necks, overlap pants, AJs, Lees.
Get us a t-shirt, some jeans, a sweatshirt with the hood, beanie. Simple and plain. The East Coast, they had big bomber jackets.
Added our own little urban style to it. We added the fat laces.
We weren't trying to say, let's make an urban clothing line. We were actually saying, let's just make clothes that we want to wear.
I don't know if Carl and I did it or not on purpose, but he was building clothes for the environment.
We was out there buying like these ski coats, these $1,000 ski coats. They were designed for a specific use, but they had a fly style to it, but we had to go pay all this money for it and then come down and wear it in the hood. But we should have been paying only $200 for it. We didn't need all that extra stuff that was in it.
And now it's like, God, fuck this shit.
Cross Colors was having a fashion show one night at Palladium. I met the owners of Cross Colors there, and I was asking them for some advice on the industry, like how can I get my stuff into department stores, and we became partners.
When Carl Kanai came out and did it with such dignity, there's really something here, there's an opportunity here.
It's just a chance of his background, his schooling, his education, and just going the fashion route.
We were the only people that was really putting clothes out there for hip-hop. We wanted to dress hip-hop. A lot of clothing companies back then were running from hip-hop.
We had to fight to get in the stores because the stores still said, we don't want that kind of customer in our store because they steal shit from us.
Hip-hop wasn't as big, but I embraced it. The artist like Tupac, he was wearing my stuff before I even met him. When I did even meet him, he didn't even want free clothes. He was like, nah, I'll pay for my stuff. You're a black man trying to do business. I want to support you.
We were fortunate enough to be able to run without. And then he said, Forrest, buy us on the low. And he was wearing our stuff. That blew us up.
I remember bringing him his first check. He opened it up and was like, you get money like this off the clothes. I was like, off the clothes, baby.
Where I was at, shipping $2,000 a month to shipping $3 million a month in just 2 months. Sean John, Rockaware, Fat Farm, all those brands have a big music influence to it. I wanted to be part of that.
Welcome to the world of Kana, the originator. Baggy jean fit for my paper.
The idea of not having fashion a part of hip-hop, it wouldn't work.
I always liked the idea of combining music and fashion.
The clothing lines that are out now, which are inspired by sports.
Richard Lynette supports me, I support them. We have a good relationship together.
Placement of our product in hip-hop videos, rap videos, on MTV, started to give us exposure.
More videos, more appearances on TV shows just exploded.
Being in America, period, where you have so much TV now, you have so many satellite stations, you get to watch and see what the real glamorous life is all really about, and it looks so good. It's like eye candy on TV, and you want to be that.
This can be corporate as well as just art.
I was the first kid from the streets that came out with a hot clothing line.
1999, we were doing less than $2 million worth of business. In 2000, we did like $2.8 million, and in 2001, we did $4.5 million, and in 2002, we did $25 million. In May of 2003, we're tracking on $45 to $50 million.
When you add up my business with Russell's business, Puff's business, Rockaware, even the other brands that are out there, all of us combined don't equal the value of Levi's annual sales.
In the publishing arena, David Mays from The Source, the magazine of music, culture, and politics, aggressively courted corporate sponsorship. With what started as a newsletter had by 1989 become hip-hop's first official monthly. Using guerrilla marketing tactics as old as the Sugar Hill Gang, he got record labels and entertainment companies like Sega to go half on a van.
Kids, they want to be like rappers. They want to live like us. They want to be like us, so they see what the rappers wear in the videos. They go dub it, man. They go try to dress like us.
A lot of designers were saying, oh, we don't make it to fit African-Americans. Well, African-Americans are not consumer, when we knew that we were spending our whole check on all these cats' clothes.
Unless I have to have a dollar in our pocket, we will make sure our outfit is brand new.
All of our aesthetic values in terms of art and illustration are born from what's happening on the street.
Versace, Chanel, Gucci, they look at us. They look at the hood. They look at, you know, the urban artists, and they take what we do and flip it a little bit.
Want to look nice every day.
If you're single and you're a man, you're going to want some booty.
Style is something that you can't take away from hip-hop.
Go to Japan, you see none but Japanese heads rocking PMB t-shirts all day long.
The Asian markets receive hip-hop completely differently than Europe does. And then you go delve inside of Europe. You know, what is hot in Paris is not necessarily hot in Berlin.
We don't love our history. We dump people after about 5 years. So for us to be in business 10 years is very, very hard because we got to always fight.
I have a clothing line coming out called Hollywood. It's only right that Little Kim has a clothing line.
Without this being that big, you would have no opportunity to make this happen.
A lot of them are getting jerked on their record deals, so they have to find other ways of making money. They have a lot of fame, but some of them don't have a fortune.
These rappers out here, just they doing what they got to do to make their money. They got to pay the bills, man.
It's affected clothing. Sean John's not making $500 million trillion for nothing. It's affected the way we shop. It's affected how we go into department stores. And we go to Armani, we go to Sean John.
It has nothing to do with hip-hop or clothing or music. It has everything to do with American culture. They're trying to maximize that name. It's the evolution of America.
The American dream is to have excess, to have more than you can use.
That's progression, man.
I don't know that the generation of younger kids today had that same kind of the purity of what it once was and how diverse it was.
Needs to start focusing more on the culture and the collective and what we're really doing this for.
Video games and tapes blew up. What used to be Atari 800 and Midway was now all about Sega and the genesis of the mixtape industry. They are credited for the creation of the Street Team, which Bad Boy Entertainment made noise with, and Loud Records chief Steve Riff, last of the Tough Juice, turned into a gold mine.
We're taking over the globe.
I don't think that the people here realize how much the control they have all across the world. Europe is listening and Asia is listening. Like, the whole world is listening to what we're doing. The whole world is listening to what we're doing.
You have B-Boy Summits, you have freestyle sessions, which bring Japan, which bring Germany, which bring America together through hip-hop. Kids have something positive to look at.
It's not just gonna be a black or Hispanic music. You have people from the Middle East, you're gonna have people all over, you know what I mean, coming out there that love the music and actually got phenomenal skills at it. It's just gonna get more global.
It's a beautiful thing, man. We love it.
We love our fans in Europe.
He sing his whole album, but they can't talk English.
Take a German kid who don't speak any English, but they come to your concert and raps all your words too.
And London pretty much is the most in touch with the States.
I went to London the first time and it was pretty peaceful and I was able to come and go as I please. But it wasn't like that this last time.
It's got everybody around the world listening to it, bobbing their head to it. The French over there, they're doing hip hop now. You go to South Africa, they're doing hip hop. You go to Japan, they're doing hip hop. And it all started from one city, New York.
I love to look out, look at the crowd, and see everybody. Like, it's all types of different people. To be able to spark that, be a catalyst for that, is dope.
You go to a hip hop show, there's every race is represented, Arabian to Japanese, and everything in between.
Tall, short, fat, skinny, white, Asian, black, Italian, that has to be amazing.
We don't do it any different over there than over here, you know? We treat our fans with respect and we give them a good show.
If I go overseas to London or Paris or France, whatever, they know everything about this culture. People that be here have no idea about rap music. They don't know who I am, these kids, you know? Because they don't care about that. They care about the now.
We got to travel the world. Hip hop has transcended many barriers, language barriers, ethnic, racial, cultural barriers, and we were a part of the beginning. It's a beautiful thing.
87, 88, I went over to Denmark. They had a grasp on hip hop a little tighter than some of our Midwest states.
All you have to do is love the music, and you can be accepted by hip hop. We all one.
I've never in my life would have believed just how much hip hop has affected the entire world.
Our mafia gained affiliation with established conglomerates, so the politicians tried to shut us down. They outlawed our music and branded it with advisory stickers. So we bootlegged our shit and got paid off the shelves and on the streets. That's just the way the mob did it back in 29 and made enough money and moves within those 13 years to launder legitimate companies. So would we. So would we. So would. So would. So would we.
Boom. Can you know kill them? We kick them a few dollars and they go and do the dance.
They bootleg sneaks, clothes, jewelry. So you know they were going to bootleg hip hop.
Stop stealing the music. It's something that's feeding certain people's families.
They fuck with us money-wise, but then it help us sometimes because we can use them as promoters.
For an independent label, it's destruction. But for a guy like me on major label, it's a little bit of destruction, but it's still promotion. So the label don't give out the shit any motherfucking way.
Black America, they'd rather go get the $5 joint instead of going to Sam Goody and getting the $14 joint.
Pussy. Two Live Crew laid the design for us to move into the porn industry in the late 80s. They had the raunchiest shows and with other like-minded sexaholics like Digital Underground and the whole Tommy Boy label, Cool Key from Ultramagnetic, Too Short, Pimpin', and more. The profiting off pussy was too sweet to ignore. Holla! For over a decade, rap music has been talking about getting paid and getting laid. Now we're both together on one stage.
They both dirty, they both raunchy, and everybody likes both of them.
That gap between mainstream and porn bridges together because it's only a matter of time.
Everybody in the game is freaky.
They want to see their favorite rapper with their favorite porno star.
For some female, probably want to see a rapper in a porno flick. Biggest selling tape a year ago was R. Kelly. The females like him more right now because they've seen how he gets down.
Despite us being considered the stepchild of major media, it's a $38 billion business. The impact that hip-hop is having on American culture and actually how Americans are spending their dollars, there's no way that these two things could not, at some point, begin to commingle. The Hustler video brought on Snoop Dogg, and together they created what ended up being the greatest selling adult videotape of all time.
And it always has been there, as far back as Luke. Come in with the honeys damn near getting bucket naked in some of the spots. That's a $1 billion industry right there. I don't get involved with anything that I don't like personally.
It was never separated.
I'll let you know, I'm one of the biggest pornography tape having this motherfuckers in hip-hop. I don't give a fuck.
Sex is a part of music, man. Sex is a part of hip-hop. It's a part of our lifestyle. Rappers are starting to get into topics that exploit that a little more, so you see it a lot more than just the bikinis now. Music, sex, and whatever else comes along.
The incestuous relationship between both industries has never been stronger. With the shout-outs and appearances of Vanessa Del Rio and Janet Jackme in Lil' Kim's video Cuttin' and Fuckin', were the aspects of a game that need no more pimpin'.
Porn is just a $1 billion business in the world, and so is hip-hop. So I guess they probably are trying to connect the way and make it a multi-multi-trillion-dollar business.
Real estate and pussy, that's it, boy. You got those two in the smash, you the man for life.
Luke's videos, they're about one butt crack hair from being a porn.
The porn industry, that's just another element of what niggas rap about. Who they sticking, who they pimping.
Putting bitches on the cover with big asses and shit. What the hell is that? Let me get this.
The girls and shit, the models and the butt naked scenes, the Miami Beat scenes, all that coincide with the music.
So. I've been approached about it. They come to you with a certain amount of money. I don't do that for $50,000. $750,000. You talk about it.
And then like a sexy lady, butt naked on the bed, and she's ready for action. You feel me?
Snoop has done the most.
Big up to Snoopy D. He be trying to throw me down on game. Like, yo, these niggas is giving up money. You need to try here. And he doing it. Fuck it.
Because if you walk in any porno spot or DVD spot, you're going to see a very big collection of big booty girls, thick black women, girls got back. And try to ignore that I know the names of these things.
It's grimy, it's gutter, and it's all about money.
Two things kind of similar, theoretically.
But the popularity these guys are bringing, it's a layup.
It only is big when a celebrity is involved. The average porn film sells like 2,500 copies. The Snoop Hustler porn has sold over 100,000.
Yeah, baby.
Cars and bikes didn't get mandated until gangster rap took over the industry in 1990. Public Enemy wasn't just the second greatest rap group of the second generation, but one of the first to make their Delta 98 almost part of the group. This turned our attention to bigger toys, that one day, kids like me would push proper.
Yo, man, why'd you break me off a loop, son?
I said that's the hood, man. You just gotta do it. Everybody wanna be fly for the time being, for that moment, man. Right now. It's urgent. Everything's urgent in the hood. You wanna come outside looking right.
My name is Fabulous. I gotta look fabulous when I'm riding around.
A lot of new cats having the Bentleys and $250,000 worth of jewelry on in the videos, going like, when I'm over with the masses. That's cool if you can possess all that shit in your videos or in your image and still come with hot shit, though. It's only a few cats that bring that element and still on the creative side come with it crazy.
You have to make something look different. So rims and a little kit here and there.
They might as well spend the extra money and finish off the car and make their personal touch on it.
Inside interior, the whole nine.
The automotive aftermarket industry is a multi-billion dollar industry. The large rims, like the 20 plus rims, increased in the market share this year 45%. His car becomes known just like he's known.
The record label trying to push a certain artist, so that's part of building up a potential superstar.
It's just something that go along with the culture. To drive one and to have a hot car, even when PE was like my 98 Oldsmobile, it just goes with music, period.
Hip-hop culture, the automotive scene, it's just one.
My drug car was a Sterling. I bought that with no money I saved up.
Cars is the biggest part of it here in Los Angeles. Snoop's coming out with his own Snoop DeVille.
They have a Sean John edition, a Navigator right now. You see that they have a Timberland endorsing Hummer. In the next 6 or 7 months, you're gonna see a lot of hip-hop artists endorsing car manufacturing companies.
You gotta wear a show now. It's a motherfucker used to have in a car. He could go out and drive his car everywhere.
Cars wasn't shit to me. I just studio money in my pocket and making records.
Everybody wanna floss, man, from when the hip-hop shit first started. And my Mercedes, young ladies,
Cadillac. The American vehicle, sedan, family on a Sunday going to church. Now it's over, Escalade, Lincoln.
I think I bought a little wheel on the little Grand March. You know, that's what we was driving in Philly, 10 and Emo all up.
We going with the times, because I'm going to get me a Bentley too, man.
It's what the people that don't rap love.
You've got people designing wheels in Italy according to how hip-hop has influenced the scene over here on the streets.
It's hard life out here in L.A., you know. We were built to break down. People think that
us as rappers. You know, they don't even look at us as musicians. They look at us as rappers, gangster rappers. They point the finger, oh man, y'all gangster rappers. Nah, we're artists. We're representing. It's an art form. And they don't see that, you know what I'm saying? The East Coast got their sayings, you got the West Coast down south. But for the West, LA is, it's just a little bit different because there's a lot of killing. There's killing 24/7 and it was just that's how it is out here, you know? And you got the dope game. You got people in federal penitentiary, everything, you know, the county, everything. It's just so much. It's just so much more than rap. Rap is just one page. You got to go through the whole book. Then you got gangster rap. You know what I'm saying? Bang life, gangster, gang banging. That's what I'm talking about. The essence, the hardcore, the core. Where Booyah Tribe, how we was raised, you either bang or you don't bang. Don't even think about it. It was like, you want to fuck with those motherfuckers? Go ahead. That was the mentality. You want to hang with those motherfuckers? You want to be a badass motherfucker? Go ahead. There go the door. Either you get dropped, you get hit. You know what I'm saying? That was just, you just don't know where, you know what I'm saying? Where you just don't know where you just don't know. You know, nobody knows. But us as Booyah Tribe, I can say, man, you know, we love the street life. It was a street life. Born and raised in life. You know? We just love the streets. I mean, that's the only thing that we proclaim, you know. We love it, man. We just love the... I can say there's more real motherfuckers in the penitentiary than real motherfuckers in the outs, and that's cold. That's a cold saying, you know. You got true people out there, and the people see Booyah Tribe, they know that we're true to the heart. We're true to the street. We ain't got nothing to hide. I ain't got nothing to hide to you. But Booyah Tribe, you see us, and you just look at us, damn, these motherfuckers, I don't know, man, you know. You can just feel it.
God gave me the love of art. Therefore, I practiced for 25 years. People are gonna look at you and say, wow, you have such a gift. Gift? Shit. A gift is a present someone kicks you down with and you ain't gonna pay them back. I earned mine through hard work, patience, and constantly looking to improve my art skills. I'm at where I'm at today. Hip-hop influenced my art, it influenced me. My whole artwork took a different direction with hip-hop. My artwork started to get a little bit darker, started to reflect the streets more. The tattoos that I do are a reflection of LA life. It's a glamorous life and a street life.
I've been getting tattoos because everything that's on me means something. Tattoo artist of Lifetime Cartoon, who does all my shit now. I only cheated on them once, though.
I got tattoos that symbolize a timelessness, like my kids. I never stopped loving my kids. That love is eternal, so that's a timeless symbol of something that I represent that I don't mind wearing to my grave.
Just different stages of my life I've been through. One arm that got like homies that passed away, Pac on this, Slash, a couple of homies. Another arm I got my kids' names. I lost count like about after 34.
Got one, Guerrilla Warfare. Guerrilla Bloodline, Cat with Guerrilla Strength, Cat with Guerrilla Breed, Guerrilla Tactics, Guerrilla Hammers. Nobody that got this tat is somebody that we don't really fuck with and consider family, so some inside shit.
This is my daughter, her name is Janae. My first real gift from God.
I always felt I was a keyboard player first and a producer and an MC last.
My son, J-Wan. The other one is LOX. Those are two things that I'm be affiliated with for life.
Hard times tatted on me, they forever gonna be with me. Parts of my life I'll never forget.
I have a tattoo of the city of Atlanta on fire, and that's what I'm trying to do, set this thing on fire.
Tattoos is out of control. When people get old, they gonna have these tattoos all over their body looking crazy.
Sitting on top of the world, just motivation for me to keep moving forward and let me know that anything I wanna do is possible in the world.
I don't know, just want to be a showy ass, that's it. Tattoos is manly, even though women get it, but it's like, you know. Tattoos is a symbolized shit. It symbolizes what you about. Are you the kind of nigga that just let any motherfucker write on your body, or do he got style, class? Is he original with his shit? So it really talks to you, but most of all, it's just to be showy.
Finally, the world was seeing the upgrade of our traditions. The fat gold rope from skinny silver. The Kangols from the Applejack, the Kazals, the laceless sneakers like they wear up north or in jail. This wasn't new to us, just got better. The appropriate sneer and swagger became mass marketed now for those on the outside. The look of the violent MC became vogue.
used to be able to get a little $500 rope chain and you'd be the man, a little puffy hollow joint for almost $1,000. You'd be the real Superman. The game has changed so much, man. These guys are going double platinum. The stakes went up, the price of jewelry went up, and they're wearing bigger and better jewels right now.
I'm in to go on and get the cheddar.
It's hip hop to the fullest. You gotta look fly, man. Not only you gotta be hot, but I mean, also gotta look good.
What we doing is setting the world up for materialistic things. It ain't all that, man. If you don't wear jewelry, man, rock your jewelry, but you know, if you're talking about it on every record you got, take it somewhere where it should be.
That's my good luck chain. So I don't really bling bling. I'm saving my money to buy a big umbrella if it start raining.
I'm all right with me. I don't need the car, the chain, or the woman to make me feel any better about me.
I love diamonds. Diamonds are a girl's best friend, for real.
I was on vacation with Puffy, this is a few years back, and he's got a Frank Mueller on, covered in diamonds, a platinum one with diamonds. And I got a platinum Frank Mueller, but no diamonds. And he looks at me and he says, I know who you are. You want the ice. I know you want the ice. Why are you trying to front like you don't want to wear the ice? And the next week I went back and I bought the watch with the ice.
Most people from the hood, they use jewelry as a symbol of showing that they're getting some money.
From back in the Furious Five days, the whole lifestyle of being rich and successful was always a statement that was made amongst the less fortunate.
For people to try to make it look like Bling Bling's new, that's bananas.
Your kids aren't eating and your bills aren't paid and all that other stuff isn't going on, but you still got a platinum chain, that's when it's a problem.
I only buy jewelry and whatnot when I can buy it three times. My grandfather told me, don't buy nothing until you can buy it three times. So don't look on TV and think that just because so-and-so blotchy block got it, I got to get it. You got to be you.
Spend what you can spend. You got bills, you got things to do. You can't jump out the window and cop something crazy. And the light's going to be off something. Cable's not going to work. You're going to miss the fight.
I take jewelry. I pawn jewelry. I snatch jewelry.
A lot of fucked up niggas out here. You niggas be getting robbed for that shit.
Ah, niggas be frying. Don't believe these niggas. Like my nigga Baby, that nigga probably got $1 million. Baby probably got 2.5 million. But most of these niggas is lying. Most of these niggas wearing platinum. It's wearing white gold. Most of these niggas is wearing motherfucking diamonds. It's wearing Misonite or the Cuban zirconium. Because you got to remember, at the end of the day, who's going to question them? Like, Rob and crew, y'all come for me. I ain't going to tell you my shit. My shit might be fake, nigga.
Motherfucker wear goddamn pantyhose on his head right now. But everybody be running around with pantyhose on their head.
Everybody likes to deal with somebody that's doing good. And that doesn't mean you have a chain in your neck that you're doing good. But there's cats right now that got all this shit and they got a place to live. Sleeping in their car. I know a few of them. Me that as a man.
Equity and property invests my money as opposed to wearing my money. And it's a lot of violence involved with that, man. From the diamonds that they mine that people died over. I'm not really into that vanities and materialisms of life because those things go and come so quickly.
Rock. Man, all this shit was a gift, man. I ain't pay for none of this shit. Everything a gift. When you work hard, look.
Not worth nobody's life, so I can rock around with some bling and shit.
People still taking rapping for a joke, a passing hope, or a fade with a rope.
As far as jewelry-wise, this was actually a hot jewelry back then. Like, if you had a house medallion.
If you didn't have, like, a four-finger ring or the name chain, gold teeth, you know, you really wasn't down.
Make yourself happy in the game, because it's all about you. You know what I'm saying? You got to do it for you.
If you can afford it, do it.
Men and women in hip-hop wear jewelry to define who they are and where they've come from and how far they've gotten.
The main message that the kids are absorbing from the images and videos are sexuality and the money aspect of it.
It's hard for a kid coming from the ghetto, man, to, you know, turn down those temptations, man. They from the hood. They from the grind. They families don't have nothing. So when they see that, they like, oh, my God, man, this is crazy. I want that.
Once videos became popular, image became just as important as a song.
From the birth of videos, it was always sexual.
It's a very sexy song. What better than to have sexy playmates?
The same thing over and over and over again. Chicks, parties.
The problem is now there is no balance.
I don't really watch videos anymore. It's boring.
Music videos have influenced kids on a lot of stuff.
Here's a young kid who's working at Burger King, and he's looking at a video.
They could cut back on it a lot.
A Bentley
with six supermodels and he's iced out.
And the dancing with the women naked, checking their butts.
It desensitizes you to sexuality, to violence.
This kid sees us and he says, well, how do I get that? There's only one way to get something like that.
A lot of kids see what's on TV, on movies, and video, and want to live that lifestyle.
It's through crime.
You know, you want what's in the video, and that's not accessible to a lot of people.
What they don't realize is the same six girls in all six videos.
The kids just got to know what's real is what's real and what's not is what's not.
We watch all kinds of other television and accept that this isn't real.
When they look on the TVs and they see $400 throwback jerseys.
What they don't realize is that the ice is rented.
And pulling up in the Bentleys.
And what they don't realize is that the car is rented.
And niggas getting off of private jets.
What they don't realize is that the clothes are from a stylist and they got to go back at the end of the day.
Kids start thinking, I ain't shit if I ain't got that.
When TV had us under control, we was watching Fantastic Four. Now, MTV got them under control.
So what happens is, in the minds of our young people, they get brainwashed and conditioned.
If it wasn't for TV or rap stars or music videos, we wouldn't know how to keep up with the fashion.
And there's no legal way to afford any of those things.
It does have a great effect.
It's good for me because I'm an adult. It's not really good for a lot of our kids who come home from school and turn on BET and turn on MTV and all they see is asses shaking and, you know what I mean, and jewelry, and it's, life ain't about that.
We don't recognize it's a fantasy.
Really ain't about a message. It's just about the artists expressing themselves, and if people want to get into it, they're going to get into it.
That's marketing and promotion, tricking the consumer.
The creativity is being dictated by Viacom with their music channels.
You're going to breeze through MTV, VH1, one of them. Your video's on there, that's the best form of promotion you can get.
They're sitting there thinking, well, is this going to get played on the radio? You know, I'm trying to eat.
Videos took it to the next level to make sure that niggas can eat real good.
Now cast is really getting an opportunity to live this shit out.
Very few people deciding what you get to hear and what you get to see, and that's never good.
That is stifling creativity.
I came from a generation where it was the shit to be creative. It was the shit to push the envelope. It was the shit to be different.
It's losing a little bit of the originality, the realness.
You had to be nice with that microphone. You had to have some flavor, and you had to be really true in this culture. Right now, anybody can do whatever and get over.
If people stop trying to, you know, sound like whoever the hottest cat is, if everybody gets their own mold, then we have a better scale of hip-hop.
Soft drums came in, people start plucking on the piano and start doing stuff and start stringing with the vibe. I mean, it's got out of control. Right now, we don't know what this is, because ain't no hip-hop.
The masses are being misinformed as to what hip-hop really is. So the masses are being misinformed as to what hip-hop really is.
It's a harder struggle, because we don't want to make the happy dappy with the, you know, whatever. I'm not from that culture. We calling names and we putting people on blast. It ain't wrong to do that, because that's what hip-hop music was. You do it now, they want to kill you. This is hip-hop. This is how it's supposed to be. The battle goes on. But now with the battle becomes a crew, which comes almost death, because people can't take it no more. The egos don't let them get dissed like back in the day. If you don't got the skills to be in the game, then don't go against homeboy. You lost that one, and forget about it. You lost it. Don't go and want to fight him and kill him.
Keep it on wax.
Create hype, controversy sells. You got people getting shot, killed, and that's how they think they're gonna make their money, till about two people get shot. Then they wanna squash the beef. These people do shows together and walk the same place together. Everybody's in the same spot. That's not no beef.
The people who control the industry, they go with whatever's hot.
Be a gangster, be this, be that. Bring in the dough.
It's beautiful, the game expanded so much and it blew up to be this big, tremendous force. But brought in a lot of fucking suckers with it.
Twinkie music.
Fake motherfuckers in the game, I hate you.
Fake plastic people. That's the worst part about this business. You have no friends.
Closer like a pimp hole business as you could get.
There's a lot of sharks out there. They're fucking scandalous.
A lot of these cats nowadays ain't true artists. They're just gimmicks. They want to get on. They think they hot. Y'all niggas ain't hot, man.
That's what's so bad.
You're in the ring, you're going to find yourself getting knocked out.
Don't do it for the money. Just do it for the love. I just so happened and tripped up and started making money in it.
It's not about so much of what you know. It's who you know. That's not what hip-hop was all about.
Unfortunately, you find a lot of artists, they're into it for getting as much out of it before they feel their time is up.
It's not moving in the direction that influenced me to get excited about the music. It's not
moving in the direction.
Just try to stay cool with the people you need to be cool with and stay away from the people you need to stay away from.
A lot of motherfuckers try to live in their past just because they was around for 10 years or 12 years. Nigga, I'm one of the first motherfuckers to do this shit. Who gives a fuck? Who cares? You ain't relevant right now, so who cares? I appreciate what you contributed at the time when you was hot, but who gives a fuck? My 10-year-old son don't give a fuck about nothing before what he can see and identify with right now. And it's not a disrespect thing, but where it becomes disrespectful is when the older motherfucker don't respect the new motherfucker that's contributing just as much, if not more, for the time that they living in. Because they gonna be old school to them niggas after them in a hot minute, and them little niggas after them ain't gonna care about their ass neither. If they not current, if they not relevant, if they don't stay in tune.
There's no such thing as development anymore. If you don't have the single that's gonna get on the Power 106s or the Hot 97s and blah, 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 all those stations that follow suit to them, then really, they don't want you.
Trying to dictate what's going to be played on the radio, what the kids are going to hear, what's going to be big and what is not. They try all kind of indirect ways to shut what we do down, but you put the pressure back on and the pressure's going to bust that pipe. Wow, because the streets is feeling it. Once the streets feel, you can't really stop.
We tend to put a lot of hip-hop artists in a box saying, you do this, you're successful with it, so only do that.
People really do it to eat, you know? If we don't do this, what else are we going to do? Slang? You know what I'm saying? What are we going to do? Go back to the streets. You know, if you knock us off on that, you know, we have no other choices. We're gonna take other avenue. We gotta survive.
Not sacrificing what's real about it for being able to turn a buck.
It is about money, but it's about how bad you want it and how bad you really want to keep it. For as much as money as you make, you have to put back into it sometimes. It's not just, you know, you take the money and you run and you have that money. You have to take that money and a lot of times it goes right back into what you do. Especially if you're a real entertainer and you're smart.
Some of these guys think that, you know, they get some money doing whatever they're doing, and I'll just buy me a chain and buy me some clothes and I could do that rap shit.
Do it for the love, and it's from your heart, and people will feel it.
I knew it was gonna grow, but not so fast, you know, as fast as it grew. But it's cool because it shows you that America's open to hear what we have to say, and that's a great feeling for the next generation.
Hip-hop immortals. That's right, we're living forever with this. Legends, what, worldwide.
This is a global presence.
Yo, hip-hop immortal right here. I'm gonna bring y'all to old school, me in the cafeteria right now. Oh yeah, that's what it is, make sure. So here we go, Clef in the cafeteria, 88, but this joint right here is called The Industry, here we go. Yeah. Imagine if Biggie and Pac never got shot, and they both still was rulers of hip hop, and Puffy and Shug was roommates from college, and Big L never got found in the alley, and Nas and Jay-Z, there were still homies, squashed the beef with Ja Rule and 50, yeah, and Benzino shook hands with Eminem, and on the same record, I heard E. Fox and Kemp. Sometime when I sleep, player, that's when I wake up, yeah, I kinda hope that the Fugees didn't break up. When I walk into the studio, I pray they didn't break, cause I missed that scratch from Jam Master Jay. Boom, boom, boom. Shots go off, mothers cry, hearses ride, homicide. Black on black crime needs to stop. Y'all can't blame it on hip hop, no, cause what we say is what we see, yeah. What I see is reality, yeah. The ghettos, you got them living in sorrow. See, they not promised tomorrow. Want to? I want to. Imagine if Big Pun was still alive. I could see Fat Joe screaming, Terror Squad. Imagine if they still was for survivors, still in Destiny Child. And TLC never lost their left eye. Imagine refugees not needing a passport. John Forte never at Newark Airport. The Million Man March, yeah, that was a start. Now I need a million more to meet me at Prospect Park. When the revolution start, y'all gonna have to play this. Free Slick Rick, he can't get the party. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Shots go off, mothers cry, hearses ride, homicide. Black on black crime needs to stop. Y'all can't blame it on hip hop, no, cause what we say What we see, yeah. What we see is reality, yeah. The ghettos, you got them living in sorrow. Cause they not promised them. I want to. In the club, I never thought Sean shot the gun. But then the limousine, J-Lo had to run. Paparazzi snapping shots through the mirror. That's when I saw that smile from Princess Diana. Back and forth and back like Miss Aaliyah. Man, do I miss her? But the war goes on with the rock and the locks. Murder Hank, G-Unit is a fight to the top. Stop, we lost too many soldiers like Freaky Top. Why to get the cover of a magazine? We gotta die. Blah! The industry right there.
Yeah.
What they say?
Cause I was rocking the whole.
How they diss people on their songs and stuff like that.
I got a jack, I gotta kill a nigga, I gotta slap him up.
You ain't gonna go and grab a gun and kill niggas because of the music, yo. You know what I'm saying? You do that, that's because you a wild nigga like that.
What we talk about is what a nigga do when he walk out of his house every day, man.
I can't expect Biggie Smalls to raise my kid. Come on. You know, come on, not off something that he bought for $15.99.
They living in the ghetto or the hood or anything, they see it every day on their day-to-day anyway.
The artists as well have a responsibility. Parents, then the kids also, you know what I mean? They got the right to choose.
You have a say. Do not think that you can be force-fed anything that you do not want to hear.
You gotta change it up a little bit. You know, kids just looking.
We get paid to do what we do. We're not doing this for free, so it's entertainment.
It's entertainment, man.
We don't control kids or nothing like that. That's their parents' job.
Hip-hop, man, is a reflection of the environment, and kids like what's real. I think kids got tired of people sugarcoating and not saying what's the truth.
This is starting from the kids in the street. You know, they feel it. The rhythmic rhyming and rap makes them listen.
The culture represents them. This is the one culture that is completely based on what they already are without them trying to be it. And because it's something that even if they're not it, feels so genuine that they want to be it more than anything else.
We all got that part of us to feel like we can't relate to what the world is talking about, what the world wants us to be.
It's an expression, it's a voice, it's a mouthpiece for the generation that's, you know, young, and they feel like they can say what they want to say through hip-hop, and hip-hop says what they can't say.
They understand that bounce and that beat. They understand that flow and that wordplay and the way you apply the metaphors and, you know, punchlines and clever shit that you're saying, you know what I mean? They identify with that. They identify with your pants hanging off your ass and fat shoelaces in your sneakers and chain around your neck and your hair cut and styled in a certain way. They get it, man, without even trying.
This was the music that your parents hated. This was the music that they wanted you to turn down, but this was the music that somebody made, especially for me.
I got kids. My kids might take it wrong one day, so I gotta live with that.
It's always up to the parents.
The parents' responsibility to motivate the kids and make sure that they understand what they're listening to and to give them the values. I wouldn't lay that at the feet of hip-hop artists.
You have to have a conscience for yourself and your children.
Kids are paying more attention to what they gotta have opposed to what they gotta have up top. You know, kids are out in the street trying to get that gold chain, or they trying to get that platinum ring, or, you know, they trying to get a $300 throwback opposed to concentrating on what they need to be. Being kids, being in school, you know, being polite. My daughter want to chase Rockaway sweatsuits all day. It's like, chill, you know what I'm saying? That's not as important as how you should be setting yourself up for the future.
What you put out into the world is what's coming back at you.
Most of the rappers, a lot of them have came from backgrounds of selling drugs, growing up without no fathers.
We need money now, so rap is something that we can do at a young age to get our families out the hood.
We found a way to take care of ourselves through our music.
Live life positively. Ways that, you know, we may have messed up in certain situations and try to correct them. I should be able to show them what I know life to be. Life ain't all good, it ain't all bad, but I should be able to show them the beauty of it, along with the struggle and the evolving and growth that it takes to be a person. I got, you know, this opportunity and this blessing to be able to speak to a lot of people. So yeah, that should be in my music, and that is one of my responsibilities. And I say that, and I speak for me. Everybody don't have that job.
No color lines, and it's all about youth. It's all about being able to express yourself with no boundaries.
It's up to us to school them.
Our element brings kids and grown-ups together that would normally wouldn't come together.
Hey, baby girl.
so I get it from my kids. To stay focused when I, you know what I'm saying, draw energy from them because they so into the music. All my kids listen to music, they all dance to it. And if I see them liking certain music, it makes me want to go make some fun music. You know what I'm saying? Come here, Jada. You know I ain't going to leave you out there. Come on in here.
That guy have great impact or just completely damaged the impact. And it's up to us.
While it may not be the world's greatest example, it certainly sets an example for young people to realize that they can have and do anything they want
to
do.
Stay in school, listen to your mom and your dad, respect your elders, and try to do more right than wrong.
During the greatest economic bullshit the world's ever seen, the third generation of ghetto superheroes emerged. Immortal ideals of the OGs and the double OGs before them. They must earn their recognition, man, and uphold the code of which we live by. In both style and body language, they must possess nonchalance, which means you just gotta spit heat, that will be remembered amidst the verb renown. Which means you're just dope. No matter how big you get, you never sweat the money and fame. Never break the code of the conduct, man. We are all kings in plain coats. The most powerful men and women in this industry you don't see. The most influential within the community, however, you see every day. You just got to know what to look for to know what you're looking at. Remember that, kid. This is our idea. Never act like any of these things fucking really matter, man. Because it does, man.
It's 2003. We weren't supposed to make it through the fucking 90s. You could say that again. Well, they will in 2010. Redundant, ain't it? And to speak of the funds we making, the tons we raking, the fun we have creating, we're real life people. With the pen, every man can be created equal if the words they speak can ring truthful. My veterans still playing this game remain youthful. I got more than forefathers. I got more like four crews who took a much longer road and paid way more dues.
So stare at your picture, man. It's not in vain.
Like heroin, seeking through a junkie's blood cell lane. They started this thing before we ever rock cocaine. After the rocks, we roll and still grapple control. Biologically, they hurt us. Rhythm wouldn't desert us. We piled the world up in the car and took the kids to the circus. See, history is more now than presidents and slavery. Mention Mac, JFK, or MLK, they gotta talk about Pun, Jam Master J, Eazy-E, Freaky Top, Pac, or B.I.G. Sorry to pause, but I could spit 64 bars of all the names that we lost in this war of ours. But them souls enchanted, implanted, and tattooed on the brick walls of our minds in wild style. A ghetto kid's brainchild. Now a mountain from a sand pile, still building. No more bumping the glass ceiling. Clumped up as bad children, little felons rebelling. It's just earth rotation, taking our turn, taking our time with no patience, making you learn, making a rhyme. Don't take this at face value. Take a look at the picture, let the rhythm inflict you. Next time you can take it as scripture. Print it in the timeline, the storybooks of all rhymes, all kinds across the compass, and all great for the posture they hold. Timeless like sprayed Krylon, Kangol. Shell toes, teaching flash to the masses. Can't defeat us, they join. Sign up for taking classes. SATs with questions on BDP, then analogies like rock chemist to Eric B. B.
Immortal Brands presents the Hip Hop Immortals.
B-boys, B-girls, B-bop, everything is hip hop. Pop lock, breakdance, break cash, everything is hip hop. Scratching, always been hip hop. Bombing, always been hip hop. The B-X, originated hip hop. We crimson, the future of this hip hop.
I'm a star child.
Yeah.
to the beach, y'all. You don't stop, I won't stop till I rock the spot. Now check it, here's a little story that must be told about a revolution with some real soul. From back in the day to the present state, from the soul sonic force to Curtis blows the brakes. From graffiti rock to your MTV rap, step back to the track, catch a heart attack. You see, now today, 2003, everybody, hip-hop is a place to be, but there's a serious history.
We ain't going nowhere. I'm here for good.
Right here,
hip-hop is immortal. Rap was born in the hood. The world gon' feel me. Y'all gon' hear me. Keep getting that money to God. Call or kill me. We ain't going nowhere.
Till we can't go.
I'm here